Thank you, Mike. I think the emeritus title just means I'm old. I think that's really what it means. Yep, thanks very much, Mike, and thanks for the invitation. Thanks for a great presentation. Orgasmic, was it? I think it was the interesting. What I'm going to talk about today really is the use of technology in the way that we maintain the golf courses, the way that we manage the turf. And I think that if you look back on yesterday's presentation, there was a lot of examples of how everyday technology that's changed is now being used. And we heard from the Nicholas companies of how they're really making big strides in some of the things they're doing and using technology. We heard about driving ranges. And when you look at all that, it's things that have changed in our lives over the last few years that are kind of making the difference. So I want to go through and relate it more to how we use technology in the turf industry, when to use it. Quite often, technology for technology's sake is not always the right thing. You know, we'll start to do something because there's a new idea. Is it really helping us either produce better turf or save money? No, it's because technology, it's kind of like you have to buy the lightest iPhone. Does it really make a difference to your life? And I think this is really important. And I'll show some examples through time what we've done. And we'll talk about the benefits. You know, and the benefits right now are not always in the initial price of a product. You've got to really look at the long-term costs as you go through a life of a product to really see where savings are coming. When you think about it, whatever we're doing and all the aspects that we've heard of golf over the last day or so, we're trying to enhance the experience and the technology of how superintendents, greenkeepers, golf managers can actually produce that turf which we're looking for the golfer. We heard a lot about, I'm not going to go up into sustainability, but as we get into this, we need to use the technology to support what we're trying to do in other ways. Conservation, environment, you know, are we saving fuel? Are we actually using the technology in support of what we want to do? And kind of going back to Andy there, the overall support of his target, what he wants to do, are we using technology for that? When we, and it's already been touched on here, but you know, there are basic elements that we really need to manage very carefully as we're looking after the turf. Water, obviously water is a big one, is that if we can save water, it's not only the cost of water that's come up now, but the, you know, in some places we're building golf, the limitations you can get for actually getting water. So we've got to find ways to really control that, use the minimum amount to be able to produce the best turf surfaces. Fuel, we've seen the fuel costs that are going on now, and can you, some of the, even the hybrid type of products now are saving 40-50% fuel costs. And you've got to take that into account when you're looking at the overall cost. Fertilizers and anything we apply to that, how can we actually control that? I kind of like this as well, as you know, I've heard over the years, and been around a few years around the traps here, but you know, we've all heard the stories about when a new golf course or what we're going to do to maintain a course. You know, the budget's never any issue and there's plenty of labor to work on the course. I think everybody has heard that. But when it comes down to reality, that never really happens. And everybody wants to produce the complete best results for the minimum input. What this chart shows, on the left, the low and high, is the quality. And obviously, we're trying to get the best playability quality that we can. But to achieve that, there are inputs that go into that. Whether they be water that I've mentioned, whether they be rolling the greens, cutting the greens, anything that we put in as a resource to get that quality. And quite often, what we see is that to achieve what we want, we are taking a safe route. We may be putting a bit too much water on here and there. We may be using fertilizers and chemicals. A good example is aerating. You know, we may aerate the whole fairway, but actually, did you need to take that big tractor and aerator out when you've actually got a compaction area that might only be 5% of that? How do you know that? And how do you look at that? And we can use, you can use technology to kind of define that and start your practices that actually reduce the inputs. What we're trying to do there, and I'll relate to this as we go through of the various things, is bringing those inputs down, bringing that cost down so that we can achieve the same turf levels at a reduced cost and input from the environment. You know, there's a lot more pressures on golf courses now to actually achieve that. I think the other one said that for Augusta, but there's some golf courses in here, and how can we achieve what Sentosa has done? Well, you saw some of the resources that is in Sentosa as well, and not a lot of the clubs out there have the same resource or the ability to do that. But that doesn't change how you can actually make savings, how you could and look at things different. I don't know, green speeds, I don't know, 20 years ago, were superintendents really asked for a green speed by not only by the management, but by multiple members as they go out as well. And, you know, that wasn't a factor at that time on green speeds. Now it is. Those things are kind of important. So I like to kind of look back a little bit, and I've been around a long time, and there's people on the left there. If you just, and I'm going to relate this to some of our everyday things as we go through. That's a telex machine. Now, there are people in the room that don't even know what a telex machine is. But when I moved into our office, Kenny and I in Singapore in the early 90s, we took over an office that had a telex machine. You know, and the way that we're so used to technology these days has changed the way we do everyday life. And that should be the same in our maintenance. Interesting, on the other side with the Google office there, obviously, you know, people now bring in their laptops and don't have a, I should have actually updated because half the people are working from home these days. And I remember through COVID how most of us had to send people back to work at home. Can you imagine taking your telex machine home to be able to you know, it's changed our lives completely. So here is a little bit of nostalgia, but that's me on that greens mower back a long time ago. Now in those days in the UK, obviously child labour was all the thing, and I was only 12 years old, obviously, at that time. I did put a tie on today, which I can't remember the last time I put a tie on, but I knew that I was following Andy, and he's always dressed so dapper I had to. But look back there. That was me demonstrating to a customer all those years ago. He wore a tie in those days to mow the greens in front of a demonstrator. But at that time, that was technology. That was a kind of a new piece of equipment that allowed us to mow the greens. Up till, I would say, about 71, there was no riding greens mower such as this. It was all walk greens. You know, and so that was a really, really good piece of technology. I can't believe I was so young there. But I got a few other examples too. The bottom one here is me, when you think about it, that was back in when you went from gang mowers to be able just to lift the cutting unit up and use two units. I mean, that was a piece of, a major piece of equipment. On the left, that would have been early 90s. And we saw in the 80s, the late 80s, the first use of hydraulic drive. You know, before that it was either all mechanical or towed. You know, and some people might say now, well, yeah, in some of the regions, maybe we should go back to that. It was a lot less technology. But it had also a lot of problems. And what I want to talk about there is technology now. We can use it in such ways that we can improve and make it simpler to operate than it ever has been before. I don't profess to be around when the top right-hand unit was actually introduced, which was including fertilization and everything else. But that was, I think it was about 20 years ago, that was at the Taj Mahal, where they still were using those kind of mowers. But just think back. I mean, to me, that's not long ago. I know there's a lot younger people in here than me. But you know, how we've kind of moved on. Kind of expectations. So what I want to go through is how we really benefit, what the future might hold. And I think as we sit down quite often and you think about your day-to-day technology, we think about things and we see ideas and we think it's going to change quickly. It takes a bit longer. It takes a bit longer for things to happen. But what I want to show you in the turf industry is what we've been working on for years, and they're actually here. In the next few years, we'll see some really big changes. And the first part is really, what's the right time to use it? These are the segments. I'm going to kind of take each of these, and many of them are in our normal lives, whether it's electric cars that somebody is driving now, hybrids, virtual reality, all these things, and just kind of related each segment to the turf. I have a question. When do we think the first electric triplex mower was introduced? Somebody throw me out a year. Where do you think? There's no, you know, there's, just throw out a number. When a triplex electric mower, when did it first get launched? 76? 80? 90? Yeah, I'll show it to you. 1925. And so again, you know, when was the right time to use electric? The problem with this one, it had an electric cord. excuse me. So you couldn't actually do some of the things. It actually had to be plugged in. But look at it, it's a triplex. And it was introduced. And at the time, the Detroit News said it's one of the most advanced ideas of our time. As far as turf was concerned. So I'm going to talk a little bit about when is the right time and when does it actually do something for you maintaining the golf course. And I'll go through electric first of all. I put one thing in here. I'll just talk about this for a second off subject. But on the right is a Greensmore powered by a hydrogen fuel cell. And we built this about, I think it was about 10 years ago. We actually showed it as a concept product at one of the shows. Totally impractical for now. I mean, the cost to build it was horrendous. But can we do it? And the reason we did it is off the back of it, the New York's Parks Authority wanted us to build 10 units of hydrogen-powered utility vehicles. And I mean, they were tens of thousands each to build. But they wanted to run them and do a test. Right now, you can't even get a hydrogen truck. You know, where do you fuel it? That's far too ahead of its time. But zero emissions, and it was a really successful. Wasn't anything we were ever going to produce. But electrics is something different. If you look up there in '96, we had a fully electric Greensmower. At that time, they were lead acid batteries, and so they had a lot of limitations. So if you look at the battery bank on there, somewhere about 3.7 liters of fuel is equivalent of 365 kilogram weight of lead acid batteries. And so although the product worked well, practicality said that on a golf course, you could probably only cut three greens. With your weight ratio that you needed to put together. Now, some people did put them on the market. We decided not to. There's a big demand, even back then, for wanting to have one or two greens cut right beside, you know, where there's housing and get the noise down. But we decided it really wasn't practical at that time. And when you look at the electrics here, we actually showed one in 2006. But it still took a long time for the battery technology to catch up to where we believe it was practical to use on a golf course. It was actually 2019 and 2020 that we had hybrid units, fully lithium batteried triplex mowers. And I'm going to show you a short video. This year was a real win for the technology. At the Open, the 150th Open in St. Andrews, all the greens were cut with fully electric triplex mowers. Now, St. Andrews wouldn't even allow triplex mowers on a few years ago. Everything was hand cut. And the technology of the cutting unit and the mounting of the cutting unit now has allowed us to give us the same cut as a walk greens mower. The electric means that they could use this with their sustainability goals in St. Andrews to actually cut all the greens. I'll show you a short video here. You may need some translation on the Scottish accents in the background, but we'll see.
Well, we're really excited about using the all-electric triflexes for the Open Championship. We've used them for a couple of seasons now, and we are blown away with the quality from them. They really help us maintain the turf and the first-class standard. On the greens in particular, we use them daily on the old course, and it is our plan to use them for cutting the greens during the Open Championship themselves. We feel that they'll deliver a fantastic and consistent surface during the Championship week.
Recently, I've been so impressed with the new E-Triflex 3370. And I mean, we've been in the industry for so long, I never thought that I would be still working in an industry where we would be having fully electric machines. And, you know, that to me is a great thing.
Our guys pride themselves on delivering the best possible playing surfaces because they realise that the eyes of the golfing world are on the old course next July. So thanks to our partnership with Toro, we know we've got the best machinery, we've got the best expertise, the best equipment, the best support, so that we can really actually hammer home and deliver on those ambitions and objectives.
So I think that's a real win for the technology. And if you look, it's a journey. It's not something you're suddenly going to do. It's developed over years and years to get to that point. But we have actually, now we can use fully electric. I like to think about it as like we see in our everyday life in the car industry. You know, you think of how that's moved forward. And when you think about it, the golf industry is not going to drive huge technology changes. So what's happened, it's kind of level with what we're seeing in our everyday lives. You know, your car now, it's a different beast than it was 20 years ago. And all the electronics and things in there is what we're able to use. So that, you know, the other thing that brings obviously is the no risk of hydraulic leads, radius dependent speeds. I'm going to talk about that on a different slide in a second. So you've now got hybrids or electrics, where you have a very small engine, you do not use very much fuel, you can run it, you know, more than an 8-hour day on one tank of fuel, if you're using it with an engine and using the generator to charge, or fully electric. And you can cut full 18 greens plus now with lithium electric mowers. I want to talk a bit about the RDS, because the other thing about using electrics is that you can control the machine much, much better. On the left there, if you look at the radius speed, and you'll see that as you turn a corner, you'll see that the, you know, less red bars, which denotes that the reel is actually turning slower as you turn. So what it is and those of you familiar with the clip of a mower, when you turn like that, normally on a standard machine, you're getting a finer clip on the inside than you are on the outside. But with electronics, you can control everything now. And so what that is, it makes a much more clearer cut, or a more defined cut around. And the same with the wheels. Now in the past, we obviously had differentials that kind of move, but now it can be so precise that the complaints you used to get with taking a riding Greensboro around the green in the same place every day and getting the wheel track, you kind of take that out. The wheel now is actually moving exactly with the turn. And so part of electronics is not just the battery saving, but it's what we can do with control. Just I think what the changes you see now is that, you know, we've had electric golf carts, obviously we've had electric kind of smaller utility vehicles. On the right there, you'll see bigger, heavy-duty vehicles now coming out with electric drive. And so that will be a kind of a game changer. The battery technology now allows us to do a lot more work than we used to do before with vehicles. And I think one of the things interesting is you're kind of setting up your workshops, or if anybody's looking at new clubs, remember, I don't know how long ago, it was 20 years, 25 years ago, when golf carts became electric, it changed the way we had to charge the product, and all the facilities were built to charge a golf cart. Your maintenance shed is going to change, because over the next few years, you will need charging stations, you will need the ability to look after more and more electric product, especially as the technology changes. But all this is available today. Just talk a little bit more about handheld tools as well. The technology now, as you'll see, from blowers, hedge trimmers, chainsaws, battery chainsaws, have become really powerful now. And you'll see more and more. So again, you kind of need to look at how you are going to manage the charging in the future and looking after these batteries. I'm going to talk a bit about what we call smart power, but again, I'll relate it back. You know, several years now, your car has been taking over some of your driving, whether it's your, the differential as a four-wheel drive comes in, your braking is really all out of your control now. And we've done the same thing on some of the products here. We actually, on four-wheel drive, if you start to go up a hill, the machine will automatically sense and move the power to where it's needed. So it takes the operator skill out of it. If you could put an inexperienced operator in and they go into an area which is, you know, climbing steeply or in wet, all these traction controls now take that out of the operator. And I think that's important when you're looking about, you know, getting skilled people to drive the products. It's much easier than it is if you don't have this kind of technology. Smart power. You may have seen outside the golf club yesterday that this product, which is, you see, it looks a bit different from an aerator product that's got four smaller wheels on. You know, we all use tractors on golf courses, but, you know, they were really made in for agriculture, for pulling a plow through the ground with big wheels on. And what you really need for turf is a product that's much more gentler on the turf. This smart power in here, they have four-wheel drive, four-wheel steer, and they have traction control. So you don't damage, you can turn on turf, and much, much less damage. But again, the operator is that the main thing here is that operator only has a single control. Very easy to operate, does not have to work on various levers to make it work. One of the other smart things, aeration is always one of the hardest functions on the golf course. You've got to make sure it's set up correctly. If you don't, you can cause some ripple issues. Once you set that up and you start to aerate, the operator cannot interfere with it. It's locked. You already set, you know exactly what you're doing. All he's doing is pressing one lever. But not only that, you can disconnect the aerator. And you might be wanting to put a top dresser or something on it. When you put the aerator back on the next week, the machine knows exactly what the settings is. You don't have to go back and do it again. So it's easier, Sam, for an operator. Just go take that machine, connect that up, and you know that he's safely going to aerate without ripping up the turf everywhere. So these kind of smart controls, again, no different to what we see on cars that we use. Here's an interesting one on hybrids. So we all seen hybrids on a car, and so some people drive hybrids around. Basically, you know, in theory, is the engine is powering the generator, and when you need it, the generator, it brings in more power. The interesting thing about this, the reason it got developed was regulations. I remember going back a few years, not as far back as those slides, but a few years ago, and remembering that, oh, you know, you've got to have a 38 horsepower, you've got to have a 48 horsepower. In fact, when you did a specification, if you didn't get that horsepower, you couldn't sell that product. And it was not based on any practical knowledge, just that, oh, that's better, if it's more powerful, it's better. This type of machine before this was a 38 horsepower. We now build a 24 and a half horsepower engine into this hybrid, and it has automatically brought the fuel savings down to at least 40. People report more than 50%. But it was driven by the regulation to say, you have to be below 25 horsepower, otherwise you've got to put all the extra on the diesel engines to make it sellable in some country. So it forced us to do some things. But this is really interesting, is that when you look on here, we did a lot of study on what power do you need. Remember, we were using 40 horsepower product in there. So the blue is 14 horsepower. This is on a fairway, everything blue there, is that's all we were using at that time. And then you see there's a few green spots, the yellow spots, you know, where you have certain undulations at the end of the fairway, you see yellow, there's a few red that actually went over 24 horsepower. So you don't need all that use and all that fuel burning. So bringing this down, though, allows you still to come up to 40 horsepower by using the electric. When you need it, oops, wrong one. Did I miss one? Yeah, if you look on the top right, it says, you know, in a normal condition, you might be using this. You bring the power in to the wheels if you need traction. And you can get up to 40 horsepower for a short period of time that you need it. So it's allowed us to save a lot of fuel. The other thing it does is, of course, saves a lot in parts. You haven't got all the hydraulic parts. It protects you from oil leaks in a lot of cases. And it's easier to operate, again, back to the operation. Just on here was, keep pressing the pointer. You know, some of the products I talked about. Down the bottom, you see some industrial trenches and some of the products that will be used, but also rotary. Rotary has been something that, you know, it takes a lot more power. Battery technology is up. We just introduced rotary products, which can now use battery technology.
When it comes,
I'm just going to talk a little bit more. Andy already showed on a sprayer there, and I'll let this run through. But this really is now starting to use GPS, which we use every day. Right? We use it in everything in our life. But what this does is connected to GPS on the satellites, and it also has a local system that defines the accuracy. So we can now spray exactly where we want to. The savings in using in chemicals is amazing. I'll let this run through and you'll see as the nozzles even turn on and off as it comes on and off the green. So you're not only just not overlapping, you're not putting any chemical where you don't need it. That alone saves more than 20% because you're leaving the up to the operator with access. So there again is how you look at the cost and the balance of what you're gaining out of some of this. I'll run through.
When it comes to spraying, precision is key. That's why Toro's innovative GeoLink system for multi-pro sprayers, the first developed specifically for the turf industry, makes it possible to spray with centimeter accuracy.
GeoLink knows exactly where you are and where you've sprayed, automatically turning nozzles on and off based on your exact location, which reduces overlaps and alerts you if you miss a spot. This helps prevent gaps and overlaps and avoids costly chemical waste. The GPS receiver uses a sophisticated communication system, connecting with multiple satellites and an RTK signal correction antenna to precisely locate your position as you spray. The easy-to-use touchscreen displays your location and lets you create and choose different application jobs. You only need to map out your course once, and the data will be saved for future applications. Want to spray only the greens? You can customize a program that includes them all in a single job. And the system offers accurate reporting that you can download for analysis. Not only will this level of accuracy improve productivity and the quality of your turf, but the added efficiency will save an average of 14% on chemical costs alone. When you think about your annual budget, you'll see the savings add up quickly. The new MultiPro 5800 sprayer with GeoLink. Innovation you can count on. Only from Toro.
I think I've said it all. I won't go through that. I notice I'm a little bit, I'm not going to be finishing early, Mike, like yesterday. So, it's so exciting. There's so much technology to talk about. It's too exciting. So I'm getting, I won't go back through that. I think that explained it all. But again, I just like to come back. It's the operation of the unit. You know, it's easy for an operator to use. You can use where you used to have a trained, and it could only be one guy that you had on the staff that could do that. This is now available to use for more people. I kind of like this, you know. It took us, 110 years to get from when the phone started to come out to where we had a push-button phone. And yet, we didn't have iPhones, what was it, 15 years ago. I mean, can you believe that of what we do today and how we have lived today? I'm just looking around, I can only see two people on the phone. That's pretty good in the presentation. But I mean, we just live by this now, right? And the technology, when we accept all that, sometimes it's hard to accept technology in other areas. So here, if you take your phone or your tablet here, this is again on the irrigation control system. It's so easy to use. It's exactly as you're using it to find your map, to walk home to the hotel or whatever you're doing. You're just using that same intuitive system. So you walk out onto the golf course. You're on the fairway. You no longer have to kind of figure out where the map is or what the number is of the sprinkler. You just walk out there and you just look at the find me, and you see you'll be standing right beside the map that shows you where the sprinklers are. And you can then control them right from your phone or remotely with your tablet if you want to. And it's real life kind of time. It's just like you do find me when you're trying to find your way home late at night. Easy to use. You can then switch on sprinklers on and off. You can manage it right there while you're standing out in the system. It has the same type of map as up in the cloud. But you know, when you look at your phone, if your map, you can either have a graphical look at it, or you can actually get the live picture of where you are. Just the same. But right on there, it's got all the irrigation heads, all the controls there, right there to hand. Here's an interesting one. I'll just show you a quick video, which is a little bit weird because there's nothing there, right? The guy is looking at. So here you'll see that virtual reality. I'll just explain this a little bit, then I'll run it again. Virtual reality, you know, it's like most of us know that the kids are using it for games. Well, maybe you do. I'm a bit older for that, so it's my grandkids that are using it. But, you know, you see the games, we've seen kind of shows, and we saw yesterday some opportunities where it's going to be used actually creating other images. We already use this within Toro now. The picture on the left, it looks like nothing's in the middle. There's a meeting I was at a few months ago, and we were looking at concept of product. So you put the mask on, and without building any product, we'd already created in the computer the concept, and you can actually walk around, look at it, see what it is. The other people in the room there can see what's on the screen, and you can actually save quite a bit in the development process just because you're able to do that quickly and make decisions. On the right-hand side, this was a trade show in Australia. We didn't put product on the stand, mainly because we didn't have too much product to sell at the time. But we put virtual reality on there, and customers can see the product, walk around it, look at it on the trade show. So, you know, we can use some of this technology to help us in other ways. I'll play that video, but what he's doing, he's walking around, and there's nothing in the room with him, but the image you see is what he's seeing, and you can go to a product, you can actually walk through it, you know, put your head down underneath and see everything inside it. Every component that the machine is made on is there. And at the end of the video, you'll see somebody coming in, taking a wheel off. Just where you've got a little handheld, you can go in, you can disassemble the machine. So you can take a look at it. We use this between our factory and our engineering office. The guys that are on each side, they're 4 hours apart, but they can actually then look at the machine, they can explain exactly what's being done. But just think, very soon, we're gonna be able to do training. Just imagine that we've got somebody we can do training over the system. They can take the parts off, they can show you how to repair something. I mean, that technology is not quite with us today, but it's very, very close now. There's another use there that we do as we're building prototypes, look and feel and seeing exactly where the controls are. I'm going to have to go a bit quicker because I know I'm getting there. But I just wanted to show you a concept. I want to talk about autonomous products. This is a concept that we showed about 5 years ago. So it's basically with no operator on it. We had it at trade shows. Again, it was positioned as a concept. And today there are a lot of machines running around with what we have aftermarket position of machines that still have seats on. But this is what we build as our prototype. The concept there of what we were doing. But what we've done on that unit is we built it from an existing fairway unit. And where you have hydraulic controls, solenoid controls, it's much harder to do for robotics. We've kind of moved on from there. And what I'm going to show you now is an actual product that we have actively running in 4 locations. And it will be on the market sometime next year. So we are now in a point of all the studies that have been going on, like I talked about the development, we actually have them running now, and it will be fully autonomous. Not sure if there's music on this one. I'll just run through now. This is the actual machine. It's based on the Greensboro, the triplex mower, but using fairway cutting units. Can you turn the music down? So that's an actual product now. It's running on golf courses. You saw the guy in the bunker there. You know, the concept that we're using is that it's almost like a shepherd. You go one guy out and he might have two or three machines, and he's doing other work as he's looking after the fairway and tearing up, and he's kind of with the units as they move on. You know, it's accepted now by a lot of people. I was on a test in about 91 in Palm Springs. We didn't have this technology, but we set up a course where we had to put poles all around the fairway, and we had it operated. It was horrendous cost in those days with sensors. And we sat in the shed, we talked about it, we had the machine start up, lift its cutting units and went off. They hated it. They really hated the concept because it was, well, hang on, what happens if he gets an oil leak? What happens if this happens? And, you know, so there was a real uncertainty about it. Today, a lot of that's been overcome. The reason we're using that unit is because we can now use the electronics. We don't have the oil issues. We can control it much better. And it's a much better way to go into autonomous than it would have been the unit 5 years ago. So that's real and is kind of here with us in the next year. I want to show you something else now. A little bit different, but on the autonomous side, 2006, we introduced a garden autonomous mower in the US called IMO, and we actually launched it. We put TV commercials out. This is a TV commercial from that time introducing the product.
The future is here. The Toro IMO robotic mower. It'll amaze you and everyone else. Another smart idea from Toro.
Smart idea, but far too early. And it didn't work. It didn't work at all in the US market. In Europe, it's different. In Europe, it's much more accepted. So that would just introduce the next phase. I kind of like relating this because it shows what work goes in and when technology is ready. This is a new unit, just introduced. It goes on the market in January, but it's vision-based. All the old units used to have a wire around them, and they used to have a random pattern, like your vacuum cleaner. It used to go all over, hit the floor and go wherever it wanted. This now you can control, you can stripe, you can do whatever you want. There's no wire around it. But it uses the vision system, the same like you see on the Google cars and the taxis that are already around San Francisco, uses a technology like that. I'm not going to spend any more time on it because I need to move on, but you see the concept. And by the way, this concept can be scaled up. Once the technology is here, and it's aimed at the garden market, which is a big market, but that can be easily scaled up now to do roughs or do any other parts. Okay, going back a little bit, 1925, I wasn't there then, that's not me. But you see that looking at irrigation control, and you see the fairway irrigation controller there. It's the guy in the middle that tows it down the fairway. And And that was just in 1925. And as you look over the years, we've had all kinds of control systems. How excited in the 80s when we had a platform, and that was DOS, and we got excited then about how that was being used. Central control now is really easy to use, multiple ways to take action. I'm not going to go into the detail, but things like running a health check, it used to be that you kind of ran it when you want. Now in the mornings you come in, the system has run itself, it's going to tell you if anything has gone wrong with it. All up in the cloud, and again, as I mentioned, from a mobile app. I think the advantages that we've seen now is where you get with technologies and irrigation is much easier to use, and accessibility, the reliability. The big thing is the upgradability. You know, through the system, you can get the latest software, can be upgraded pretty much instantly. So that technology has really helped us through that. I'm going as quick as I can. One thing, and Andy mentioned individual head control, and that really changed things. But when you look at it and you look at how much water you want to put on, you know, you don't really want to put time and 4 minutes on here or there. And you look at a green, which is not regular shape, you actually need to put the same amount of water on. You can program each head and to the second, but it gives you the exact amount of water. So each sprinkler will be a little bit different, and you can control that individually now. I think my time is pretty much up now. I'm not gonna go over some of this. Andy mentioned the accessibility there. I'll just take two more minutes and then I'll finish up. So I guess the reliability, precision, you can upgrade systems and really control that water usage. One other thing I just want to talk about is collection of data. I think pretty much everybody now uses some kind of handheld water sensors, water meters, various ones, and you can actually create maps on them. We've done a lot of work in collecting various data so that you can actually manage those inputs. Right back to the beginning, remember I talked about inputs? You can actually manage those. This is a little machine that you can throw around and it can measure hundreds of points. Can you hear me okay? I think my mic. Okay. You can measure hundreds of points across the green. What it's doing, it's measuring salinity, moisture. It's got a penetrometer to give you the actual surface hardness, and the spectrometer is on the back. And then it all takes GIS, puts it all together. You can create a map for the course. And what that map will show you is soil moisture, salinity, in a map format like that. And, you know, a lot of people have used this, and some of the new turf managers here kind of know what your golf course is like, but they use it to sell to the management when they need some budget or some to show where the problems are. It's actually a great tool for that, or to share with members where the issues are on the course. You can do irrigation audits of the management zones, you know, looking at individual areas. I could have used an hour and a half. Just one brief thing on the soil moisture. Here you see the NDVI camera against the moisture sensor, which is in the ground. And there you see where you've got a real blue area where it's moist, and it could be like more water coming from that sprinkler. And you see how the green lines up with it on the NDVI camera, and the drier spots. You've got to be careful with cameras though, because other things affect that camera. You could have grass clippings laying there, it would be red. But you've kind of got to know what you're looking for on that. Sensors that you can put out, wireless sensors that you can pull into the system. Drones, we've heard a lot about drones. This one it sits on the roof of the clubhouse and they fly it once a week. Gives them a map. Again, it takes the NDVI and actually shows you the condition. It's more of a tool to help the manager. He kind of knows where the issues are. Just the last thing I want to just talk about is that we talk about all this technology and things. How are we ever going to manage that? You know, we've got to look at how we can bring all these things together that we've talked about. And you think about it, all this data is coming in to different places, whether it's your battery on your mower, your what we've talked about coming from your drones, your weather. All this is coming in, and it's all part of managing the turf. We have an asset management system that actually has all your product registered, so it manages your work orders, what you're doing with it, when it needs filters changing, and that's automatic. As you run through, as you come out of the shed, it clicks on. As you go back in, it clicks off, but it records how many hours that product has run. And then it creates your work order in your shop to be able to manage how you do that. So how do we pull this together? Well, you need a dashboard. And we have what we call IntelliDash, which is taking all that together. You already have your irrigation control system right there that you're looking at. So now we're going to take the data so that you've got everything in front of you. So the technology that we've talked about for various things can be pulled right into one place. You're looking already at weather. You're looking at your irrigation. Well, you can look at your equipment tracking. You can look and see where it is on the course. You can look at all these things in one place. And it's simple by little blocks. You can hide them, the ones that you don't want to see right then. You can actually bring forward. I'll just run this. I was going to spend a bit more time, but I'm running out of time here. So here's what it kind of looks like on the dashboard. And you'll see it'll pull up various squares. Remember, you can have whatever you want. The weather are there. It's got irrigation running stations that are running. It's got your moisture sensor readings coming in. Your weather map that you pull locally, your local weather map. Here it's got your assets and what you're doing in mowing greens. You can actually set assignments out to various people. You can GPS track where the product is on the map. How many units are under repair that maybe are not usable for the course that day. Spare parts, you can look up on there, pick your actual product, get your spare part number very easily, order your spare part on there. All in one dashboard. Sorry, I rushed through that, but I think you get the picture, is that this technology that we're doing, we really need to kind of pull together. Just to finish, look at that. It took 75 years when the telephone was introduced to reach 50 million people. As you read down there, the bottom one is Pokemon. It took 19 days to go around the world to reach 50 million people. Henry Ford, I like this quote, you've asked people what they wanted, you know, they would have wanted faster horses rather than motor cars. And I think this is a good thing to think about change. The picture on the left, this is the Fifth Avenue, New York in 1900. All horse and cart carriages, right? The same image 13 years later is all this one horse. The rest are all cars in 13 years have changed. That, I think, is kind of amazing to kind of, and relate some of the things that we're doing and what we've said on turf is, hasn't been here, but it's here now. We weren't quite so quick to take the horse off the golf course. It was 1921 before we took the horse out of gang mowers and put that on the golf course. So I'm very quickly going to sum up. Don't just look at the initial cost, because the total cost of ownership is really important in these products. Don't be afraid to use it. It helps with labor. It helps with people understanding and ease of use of products. And it relates to the rest of our life. Technology is what we've included in turf. Sorry I ran over a bit there, but thank you.